gave him the command to show me his hands, and he showed me his hands right away.
I tell him I don't see a weapon. Do you? And he said no.
Some people thought he might have had a gun.
Deputy Willard and I started to approach him, you know, tell him to get on his stomach.
And I had my taser on the guy, and I'm talking to him the whole way I'm walking up there. And I said, sir, we're going to get you some help. And really, as I got up to him and saw him sitting there in the condition of the burns, and I'm sort of assessing him physically, my main concern at that point is, well, two things. One, I decide I'm not going to let this man leave here again. But secondly, and almost as important, was I need to get this man medical help. He needs help right now. But I need to make sure we're safe. We're safe. Make sure we're safe. We're safe. Make sure we're safe. We're safe. Safe. So I tell him I need him to turn around and lay down.
And we're like, get on your stomach, get on the ground. And he'd be like, okay, no.
And he looks up at me and he says, no. I said, you've got to do this. I need you to lay down. And he says, no. Again.
And we had told him to get on his stomach or he'd be tased.
You're going to be tased if you don't lay down. I said, repeated that several times. And again, he just kind of leaned forward and went back to just ignoring me. At that point, I was just about to deploy the taser, and the Sandy officer deployed the taser.
Discharged my taser weapon and got a good shot with the taser on both prongs, went in his back, flopped backwards on the ground. Kind of a few times, he just kind of sat there while he was, before I tased him, just kind of sat there and shook his head. After the first time I tased him, just from his behavior and the ineffectiveness of the taser, you know, I even made the comment to Deputy Willard because of his behavior. I'm like, I don't want to get hands-on with this guy.
He did that. The guy went on his back, flat out, prone out on his back on the ground, and was shaking a little bit, fairly typical of somebody who is taking an electrical shock. And then when he was all done, when that 5-second shot was done, I said to him, you need to do what we ask you to do. We need you to get over and lay down on that grass. If you don't do what we ask you to do, you're going to get tased again. You need to do what we're asking you to do. Again, I'm still looking at him and assessing him, and I start thinking, I don't want this guy anywhere near me. And I'm thinking, if he complies, what am I going to do? He's got blood literally from head to toe and multiple lacerations and cuts and dirt. And I didn't want to touch this man. I really felt there was a real risk to my safety. And to the officer that was there.
Deputy Willard, at this point, I saw that Deputy Willard also had a taser out and attempted to tase him.
I deployed my taser at the same time.
The prongs from my taser were still in him while he was on. So I did another pull of the trigger with the taser.
I noticed it appeared that one of the barbs actually was a good hit, and the other one was in him, and he was getting the shock from my taser, but it wasn't really. It stuck and it hung on, and he started to get up on his left side. He started to go up on his side towards me, and the Sandy police officer hit the taser again. He fell back on his back, reached back, and knocked my one taser, one barb off. Well, I started to go after him to get close enough to so that the taser would continue to be effective, turned and faced us.
And then he started growling again.
And I went for another reload. As soon as, just almost at the same time he turned around, he started screaming, I'm going to kill you, I'm going to kill you, and running right towards me.
And then started to charge at Deputy Willard, yelling, I'm going to kill you, I'm going to kill you.
There were 9 other witnesses close enough to see and hear everything that happened. Not one of them heard Mr. Cady scream, I'm going to kill you, at the officers. Not one.
Deputy David Willard told investigators, quote, he started screaming, I'm going to kill you, I'm going to kill you, running right towards me. I was scared.
I ran around, started to run around the rear of the police car, And I looked back, and he was gaining on me, and he was about 3-4 feet behind me. That's when I decided that this man needed to be stopped. I couldn't let him go. I was scared. And I transitioned to my handgun.
And I got my firearm out. At this point, the subject jumped up onto the hood of my car, still charging towards Deputy Willard.
And he was up on the very top of the Sandy police car, towards the rear window, jumping up and down and screaming, "I'm going to kill you, I'm going to kill you." I remember clearly yelling two things. One, "I'm the police and you need to get down." And I think I yelled, "Shoot." I might not have. I might have just been thinking it. But in any case, when it appeared he was going to leap off of the car at me, I fired
several shots at him.
And then it appeared that he was going to come towards us, but down towards the trunk. I fired one more round, and he fell on his back, right against the lower right rear window, and then hit the car, slid off of the car head first, and then his head hit the ground. And my actual thought was, it's weird, it was all in slow motion, but my actual thought was, I can't let this man get me. I can't let him touch me. He has to be stopped, but I can't let him touch me because of the blood. Because of the blood, and the blood thing was really bothering me. The blood thing was really bothering me.
I just knew that he was either had a very bad mental health problem or was definitely under the influence of drugs or a combination of both.
According to witnesses, there was something wrong with Katie that morning. Witnesses say he looked like he was high.
Catatonic.
The Sandy police officer involved in the shooting is already back at work. The deputy involved is not back to work yet, but could resume duties before this internal review is finished.
A shooting review board cleared two officers in the shooting of Fuad Katie last September.
And the sheriff's office shooting review board also determined that the deputy did not violate policy.
Those officers were justified.
No criminal wrongdoing in the shooting.
There was not enough evidence to file criminal charges against the two officers involved.
The board of police members reviewed the case. The board of police members reviewed the case. The board of police members reviewed the case.
Communicating with CCOM from the moment he stepped out of his car to the moment that Fuad Katie lay dead at his feet.
Edward 2.
03 medical. And a couple more cars here.
Copy, being confirmed location. I know it shows 362 and Van Meter crossing. Edward 2, confirm your location. Edward 2, can you confirm your location on 362?
To Edward 2, code 3 medical, shots fired.
Blood thing was really bothering. Blood thing was really bothering. He has to be stopped, but I can't let him touch me because of the blood. He's not doing anything. He's just sitting just like this.
The first thing they said to me, if I yelled or making any noise, they kill me.
You may remember that Abner Luima was allegedly beaten and horribly sodomized with a toilet plunger inside the 70th Precinct House last summer.
They told the sergeant that they wanted to file a complaint. And he says, the name of the person, he said, I want to file a complaint about...